Good evening. Welcome. I'm Mark Updegrove, the director of the LBJ Presidential Library, and I want to welcome you all here tonight for what is the last of our programs of 2015. It's been a great year, and thanks for making it so. Tonight, we welcome back to our stage S.C. Gwynne, who will be talking about his latest New York Times best-selling book, Rebel Yell, The Violence, Passion, and Redemption of Stonewall Jackson, of which the Wall Street Journal wrote, Gwynne's easy loping style wraps itself effortlessly around the particulars of Stonewall Jackson's life, from his back of the mountain upbringing to the outburst of military genius in the Civil War. The result is a narrative vivid with details and insight. Many of you will remember when Sam joined us several years ago to discuss his best-selling book, Empire of the Summer Moon, The Story of Quanah Parker and the Rise and Fall of the Comanches, which was a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize. To say that that book was successful hardly does it justice. Sam spent most of the last 14 years as a writer at large for Texas Monthly, and prior to that worked for Time Magazine as a senior editor and bureau chief. Earlier in his career, he served as a teacher and international banker. The latter stint resulted in two critically acclaimed books, Selling Money and Outlaw Bank. Leading tonight's discussion with Sam will be Talmage Boston, a well-known Dallas attorney and the author of three books in his own right, Raising the Bar, The Crucial Role of the Lawyer in Society, 1939, Baseball's Tipping Point, and Baseball and the Baby Boomer. He has also moderated discussions with, among others, Henry Kissinger, Michael Lewis, Ken Burns, and Frank DeFord. Before I bring out Sam and Talmage, Sam has given us an actual rebel yell that we will hear by audio tape. So I will ask the booth to play you a rebel yell, which is the sound of the rebel yell that you would hear during the Civil War. So if that didn't scare the hell out of you, I can guarantee it scared the hell out of Yankee troops. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming to the stage S.C. Gwynne and Talmage Boston.
Thanks, Mark. Thanks,
Sam. Which side am I going to go this summer? I'm going this summer. Okay. Okay.
Good evening, welcome. Sam, let's start with the title of your book, Rebel Yell. We just heard it, and we know that Stonewall Jackson started the yell at First Manassas when he told his troops, when you charge, yell like furies. And that, as you describe it, feral, eerie, corkscrewing sound that sounded like it was coming from the pit of hell, worked so well that the Confederate troops used it in battles throughout the Civil War. But what caused you to choose Rebel Yell as the title for your book about Stonewall Jackson?
Well, it was, you know, when I was looking around for a title, I discovered that he had been that his men had been the first one to do it, and they had done it at his request. And by the way, I don't know if Virginia country boys thought the Furies were Greek vengeance deities. I'm not sure they knew that. But whatever they thought it was, they did it, and they yelled. And so I found that out, and I immediately thought, well, that's the best title I've ever heard in my entire life, Rebel Yell for a book. So, and I thought, okay, and 700 other people have already used it as a title for a Civil War book. So, and we live in the age of Google, and I hit the thing, and it was like 600,000 hits, and I just went, oh, give me a break. And then I realized as I went through it, they were all Billy Idol. You know what I'm talking about? The rock star who did the song Rebel Yell? No one had done it, so it was there. So to me, it was just this miraculous, I mean, one, it was closely associated with Jackson himself. I think that, you know, we'll get into this, I suppose, but, you know, he was, you know, he gave the South a sort of a myth of hope and invincibility at a time when they didn't have it. And so it was, in a spiritual sense, I guess, a yell of the underdog.
Now, I think most people know that typically the big bucks in writing biographies these days go to people who write presidential biographies. And to use oil field lingo, books on presidents are proven developed acreage. Yet you've chosen to be a semi-wildcatter, stepping out into less developed territory with your coverage of Quanah Parker first and now Stonewall Jackson, who are two lesser covered historical figures. Were you thinking like a wildcatter when you chose to write about Stonewall Jackson and Quanah Parker with a mindset of high risk, high reward?
With Quanah, I didn't really think there was going to be a higher reward, and I never actually thought of it that way, because it was just something I wanted to do. It's one of those rare things where, I mean, I'm working at Texas Monthly. I'm an executive editor. I have a good life, and you know, I sort of said to myself, I said that, you know, I reminded myself that when I was younger, I had been an ambitious person, and even though I was doing well at Texas Monthly, I hadn't really been swinging for the fences. I sort of thought of it that way, and so the Comanche book was really that. I just wanted to do it, and so I did it. And I, however, once you have an international bestseller, the equation changes. And for this one, it was quite a different model, because now the expectations, which were zero on Empire of the Summer Moon, I mean, the first printing there was 6,000 or something or less. The first printing here was 75,000. I mean, it's different levels of expectations. So yeah, I mean, with Rebel Yell, here's what happened. I mean, I wish this upon all writers. If you do happen to have a bestseller, this was my third book, and the other two were not bestsellers, but a window opens, however briefly, and the window is that you can sort of maybe do what you want, or you'll be allowed to do what you want. And so I went back with Jackson, and I just went back and tried to think of the most interesting thing, the person that in my past just captivated me. And to me, he was the great story of transformation in the Civil War. I mean, 14 months from obscure, eccentric physics professor to most famous military man in the world, you know, say no more. So that was it.
Well, your book describes how Stonewall Jackson had a dual personality in many respects. He was fundamentally unrevealed and self-contained when he was around men, whereas he was able to open up with select women. He was, as you said, a social misfit nerd before the war and this glorious military leader during the war. He owned 6 slaves, and yet he had started what proved to be a large Sunday school class for slaves at his church in Lexington. He hated the prospect of war, and yet when the war started, he was the ultimate attack dog. He was a devout Christian, yet in wartime, he became a remorseless killer. Can we compare him to Hector in the Iliad, who was really two men, a ferocious warrior who inspired affection and trust from his comrades, but who had the capacity to turn it off, turn his war mindset off, and become a gentle, loving, thoughtful family man when he wasn't in war?
Well, you've given me a very complex equation there. And in fact, what you just described was Jackson, and the reason I think one of the holds he has on the American imagination is he was a tremendously complex person. When you think of some of the great generals who were complex people, MacArthur was one, Patton was another. But yeah, it is hard to resolve all these contradictions that are inside of him, and that his devout Christianity, among others, which is really the key to him. You have a man who, which you alluded to at the beginning there, and well, in Lexington at the beginning of the war, I mean, he was just seen as kind of the odd major. He was he was a bit of a hypochondriac and an eccentric, and he did, you know, he kind of obsessed about his own health, and he was painfully shy, and he was, as a teacher, the worst teacher that anyone had ever seen. And he was, you know, in his classes, and he would, as a teacher, he would call you to the blackboard for your recitation, for a brutally difficult lesson in what we would now call physics. And then if you missed anything or had a problem, he would simply quote back to you the text that he had committed to memory. And so you would think that maybe a stickler, this was another part of the two sides of his personality, that a stickler for discipline like that, a stickler for detail like that would have been a stickler for discipline too, but in fact, the reverse was true. Turns his back, spitballs everywhere, cadets mimicking his strange step from behind him, trussing cadets up, this is at the Virginia Military Institute where he taught, trussing cadets up on the door so that they would tip over when he came in, removing the linchpins from the cannons in his artillery class so the cannons would go spinning down the hill with the professor. And so you had this guy that was kind of a loser. I mean, he was one of that great undifferentiated mass of people that weren't, you know, that good at anything. And one of the things he really wasn't good at was leadership. Again, you know, you brought up so many points in what you just said, that question, that we may have to get to them as we go, because this idea of Jackson, he did have a bit of a dual personality, because with his two wives and one of his wife's sister, he was this entirely different guy who spoke Spanish baby talk and in the house and was joyous and had a different view of things. And everyone in Lexington and the war would have been astonished to know that that's what he was like in private.
Mm-hmm. But can't an argument also be made that Stonewall Jackson had a lot of Achilles in him? The man who wanted to fly the black flag and take no prisoners, who told his VMI students in time of war they should draw the sword and throw away the scabbard, the man comfortable with, as you call it, headlong, man-wasting aggressiveness, and a man who, after a battle, whether it was Malvern Hill or Antietam, wanted to keep on fighting him and just didn't want to stop. So was he unique among the Confederate generals for his hyper-aggressive approach to warfare?
He was very unusual among any generals early in the war. And early when the Civil War began, there was really no model for it. A lot of these generals had been in the Mexican War, and so there was that kind of that war as a model. But things had changed. Weapons had changed. It was not the same war. There were trains, among other things, that hadn't been there before. And so Jackson, to me, was this sort of model. He was one of the first generals, I think, who really appreciated, one, how hard the war was going to be, how bitter, how ruthless, how cruel, how violent, how absolutely shattering it was going to be. He got that quickly. And one of the reasons he advocated a black flag war, meaning take no prisoners, in the North, that he wanted to go burn Philly and burn Pittsburgh and burn Baltimore right away, the theory was make them feel the pain so badly that they would have to come to terms. Well, we sort of did the same thing in Japan in World War II. But Jackson was one of the first who really embraced exactly what the war was going to require. So you saw him doing these marches that nobody, the likes of which nobody had ever heard of, being able to march men for huge distances in the Romney campaign through ice, men barefoot in the ice. Jackson didn't care. He pushed them. He marched them. He was an advocate of total war early on. He was, as you said, he had to be restrained. In fact, it got him killed at Chancellorsville. He wanted to drive Hooker into the Rappahannock in the darkness, and that's what got him killed by his own men. But he was a prototype in the war. There was another general in the West, or in theater, Ulysses S. Grant, who was similar in some ways. This extremely aggressive, decisive style of command. I mean, so many of these generals in the early war they lacked what Grant would have called moral courage. And, you know, this idea that you can make a decision and stick with it. This idea that you make a decision that might endanger your army. The army might be destroyed. It might be captured. You and your generals might be killed. You could make a decision and you were in a land that you didn't know, in a terrain that you didn't know, against men who wanted to kill you, who were off somewhere in a place that you didn't know. Highly risky, highly volatile. Jackson had this uncanny sense of not only decisive grasp of terrain, decisiveness. I'll just give you one story and then I'll stop here. But there was a Union general named Robert Patterson early in the war, and he's crossing over from Maryland into Virginia, and he's pursuing Joseph Johnston at that point. And
The high command in Washington is trying to get Patterson to move, to get him to go and just go get him, you know, go get him, Tiger. And Patterson wouldn't do it. And he was goaded and goaded and goaded. And finally, he sent a wire back to Winfield Scott, and he said, look, if you want me to do this, I tell you what, you send me an order, and in that order, you specify exactly what you want me to do, where I'm going to advance to, how I'm going to advance, where I'm going to invade the enemy, what I'm going to do. And then I'll be happy to do it. So Patterson's point was, he didn't want the responsibility. If Winfield Scott took it, yeah, sure, sacrifice the army, who knows what was going to happen to it. But that kind of moral courage, Jackson was both unbelievably aggressive, I would say he's possibly the most aggressive commander America's ever produced, but also willing at all times to be decisive and to take that responsibility for a decision, which of course did, as Grant suggested, bear huge moral consequences, not only for his side, his men, his officers, and himself. Mm-hmm. That was a long answer.
Now, you've used the word once already, but your book frequently describes Jackson's transformation, his being a different person altogether, even a transfiguration when he prepared for battle or was on the eve of battle or was in battle, when, as you say, the light of battle shined its radiance upon him. So as far as history's most esteemed war heroes go, was Jackson's extreme transformation in battle unusual, or is that what the great warriors do?
I think a lot of the great generals were very brave men. By definition, almost. You couldn't be, it's my expertise is the Civil War here, but you really couldn't be a great general without being a very brave person. As I said, because for one thing, generals died at a much higher rate than the grunts down below did, so it was your own skin that you were risking. So Jackson was... when Jackson went into battle, is what you're talking about, they said he kind of glowed with the light of battle. It brought out something different in him. He was a transformed man. And it's interesting if you look at his career, because there were two things that it turns out that he had a talent for. And one was God and religion. His real calling should have been Presbyterian minister. I mean, he thought about God all day long. He consecrated every act that he did to God. He prayed during battle, almost lost one of his fingers praying during battle, prayed in his tent. God was not outside of or somewhere else. God was completely within and permeated his life. He should have been a Presbyterian minister. He was the worst, he was as bad a public speaker as he was a teacher, for one thing, and he had no social skills, he was, and he realized that to be a pastor, you couldn't really do that. So in that sense, he was a failure. He was not an outright failure in the sense of having tried it, but he did do it on a small scale at the Sunday School for Slaves in Lexington. But he hadn't succeeded. So there you put that. So that's one thing that he was good at. Okay, the other thing that he was good at was war. Now, in the Mexican War, the bravery that he showed was so extraordinary, it was just absolutely astonishing. You can have to picture this near Mexico City. There's a big battle going on. The Mexicans are defending Mexico City, and the American troops are marching in, and there's a point at which the Mexicans have focused all of their firepower, their guns, their artillery, and their musket fire, and everything else on this one particular patch of road. And there's a moment when Jackson ends up out there all by himself. Mm-hmm. Everybody else is ducked for cover because there's way too much lead and stuff flying around there. But Jackson's standing there literally alone with one cannon in the middle of that road in this hailstorm. And it was funny because he said, as he stood there, when everybody else diving for cover and getting out of there, he was saying to the men, it's fine, it's perfectly safe, come out here and join me. Which he later said was the only lie he ever told. He was incredibly dangerous, but the point was, this was witnessed because it was so extraordinary and because of the way it was set up. It was witnessed by a division commander, it was witnessed by a lot of people. He was singled out, he was promoted for it, it was an extraordinary piece of bravery. But there's the blue light. There's that glow of battle and war that he was good at. So but what happens next? We just said that he couldn't be the Presbyterian minister that he should have been, probably. He goes into the peacetime army. He's not suited to the peacetime army. It doesn't work. He has a very bad time of it in Florida, actually. He causes trouble, and it's not his place. And then he goes to become a professor at a military institute of physics, which is not his place either. He's no good at that either. So we have these things that he's good at, right, that he sort of doesn't get to do. And one of these, you know, he was famous for being obsessed with his health and all this things wrong with him physically. Well, all those things magically disappear when the war starts, strangely enough. But he, you know, he was very much transformed by the war. And I think one of my arguments is that he really, this was his calling. He was really good at this. He knew everything about war. He was great at every aspect of it, really good at administration, good at marching and maneuver. As a tactician, he was okay. I mean, he was B-plus tactician, but at almost everything, he was absolutely flat brilliant at it. And so what happened during the war, and this happened to other people too, Grant being and Sherman being famous failures before the war, who suddenly this other talent gets brought out. And so so Jackson was not unique. I mean, in a war where transformations were, you know, common. The Civil War made a specialty out of transforming people, right? In most cases, it was the glorious senator or congressman or businessman who ended up as a cowardly or incompetent general and quickly washed out. There's a whole bunch of political generals that happened.
Reverse transformation.
Then you had the famous ones like Grant, you know, leaning on the broom in his father's store in Galena, Illinois, a few months before the war, a failure at everything he'd done. Sherman, teaching at a little military school in Louisiana, a failure in all of his business ventures. Those guys were transformed the other way.
Now, talking about his faith and his being a Presbyterian, when you say the word Presbyterian, the word that pops into most people's mind is predestination, the theology that everything that happens in life has already been set in stone by an all-knowing, all-powerful God. So was it Jackson's Presbyterian belief in predestination that empowered his ferocious and often reckless courage in battle?
He would have probably answered that question, yes. I mean, Jackson was always riding into the heat of whatever it was and standing there amid the shell fire. He should have been killed 10 times over. He was always doing that, and at some point, one of his staff said, you know, General, how can you do that? How can you stand there sit on your horse there? And what he said was, I've never felt safer in my whole life. He said, the reason I feel so safe is because God has appointed the hour for my death, and that is already been appointed. It's already going to happen.
It's predestined.
I can't do anything about it. It is predestined. Now, his beliefs were not, and I would argue, not entirely predestinarian. There was plenty of wiggle room in the middle there. But yeah, in that sense, he believed that that everything was in the hands of God. He believed that all of his battles were in the hands of God. He believed that he did not deserve credit for any of his victories. He not only believed that, but he thought that if he were given credit, it was a form of idolatry, of sort of worshiping a false idol, in this case him. And it would actually result in the fall of the Confederacy.
Mm-hmm. Now, besides his devotion to God, his other all-consuming focus during wartime was on a soldier's duty. Duty was duty. You shirked it at your own peril. And this obsession with duty caused him to refuse a soldier's request to attend his child's funeral and to be in conflict with soldiers from generals to his VMI friends who crossed him or who retreated without orders. So among the great military leaders of the Civil War, was Jackson's all-consuming focus on duty atypical, or is that the norm for a soldier?
I would say it was highly atypical. His idea of what duty was quite strict and did extend to his generals, who he often fought with and often put under arrest. And he arrested more of his colonels, he just arrested people whenever they did not do what he believed was duty. You asked, was he unique or something? Well, I'll give you just one example. Robert E. Lee never arrested any general, not a single general. Jackson was doing it every other day, it seemed, for a while. At one point, he had half the general staff in half of the generals in some form of arrest. But yeah, he had a very, very clear and particular sense of duty. I think it got in his way. Mm-hmm. But I would say he was an extreme.
Yeah. Now, one of the tools that you use in making the image of Stonewall Jackson so vivid in the book is to compare and contrast him with other key historic figures of the time. A really cool comparison with the abolitionist John Brown, comparisons with U.S. Grant and contrasting him with McClellan, and then in the end, just an unbelievable comparison between Stonewall Jackson and Abraham Lincoln. So is drawing these parallels between people part of your process in bringing your story into clearer focus of the characters that you're trying to portray?
It was very much so, and I discovered the technique, or I didn't discover the technique, but I discovered that I could use the technique in writing my book, Empire of the Summer Moon, when I decided that the best way to look at my character, Ranald McKenzie, who was this great Indian fighter that nobody ever heard of, was to twin him with Custer, who was the really bad Indian fighter that everybody had heard of. Both were Civil War heroes, and so I did it in that book. I just twinned them, and I paired them as a way to show it. And so I did it again in this book, and as you say, John Brown, Jackson, Jackson, McClellan. Jackson and George McClellan was the great early Union general, and he and Jackson were both members of class of 1846, the class that produced 22 generals, 12 Union and 10 Confederate.
Out of 59 graduates. 22 generals out of 59.
Quite a class. And here you had, so McClellan, by the time, McClellan is a borderline genius. He's very, very smart. And he comes in, he's already been to the University of Pennsylvania and graduated by the age of 16 when he starts West Point, which, by the way, is the best engineering school in the country. His father's a prominent doctor. He's a Philadelphia blue blood, right? And so on the other hand, you have Jackson, orphan hillbilly from Appalachia or whatever. He was a completely different case. Jackson, basically McClellan came in at the top of his class and left at the top of his class. Jackson came in at 164th and barely made the cuts as he went. And so I just compare the two. It's an interesting comparison. Among other things, by the end, of course, McClellan graduates second in the class and is disappointed in that, but he's the valedictorian or whatever of the class, and he sort of goes out the way he came in. Jackson, meanwhile, started out and was called the immortals, the people who couldn't do anything, the people who were almost certainly going to wash out, and West Point was brutal at washing people out. I mean, you're going from 164 people down to 59. Just every year they just whacked them. They had exams, and if you didn't pass the exams, you were gone. So here's my theory about Jackson. So Jackson comes in to the finest engineering school in the country with a very spotty rural Western Virginia, now West Virginia, education. I mean, a really bad education. I think, and it's hard to get equivalencies here, but I would think it might be an eighth grade education as we would conceive of it. If that, and the math that he had was, he had had no algebra as far as I know. So that actually, let's just imagine for the moment somebody coming in to the University of Texas Engineering School with a seventh grade education and no math. Just think about that for a moment. Think of how smart you would have to be to perform. Now, Jackson made the first couple of cutoffs he made by the skin of his teeth, but by the end he was 17th out of 59, rising fast. The hardest course of all, he got a fourth out of his class. I mean, people there said that another year he might have led the class, but it was an extraordinary act of will to do that, to be able to get through that. And I think, going to UT engineering on that kind of education is a good comparison. So anyway, that was true. And then I'll say one more thing about, Lincoln. One of the things I think most historians have missed about Jackson's death, it was the first great outpouring of grief for a fallen leader in American history. And it's sort of jarring to hear that, because you think, well, wait a second, you start to think, wait a minute, Adams and Jefferson. But in fact, it really was. Franklin was old and obese when he died. He got 20,000 people in Philadelphia. Washington, Adams, Jefferson had very modest funerals as old men. Zach Taylor got 100,000 in Washington out to his funeral procession. But
He was a president who hadn't been there very long. And Jackson's death absolutely transformed the entire South. I mean, it shattered the South. It was a very close comparison to the death of Lincoln almost exactly 2 years later, which, of course, has overshadowed Jackson's death in history. But to look at the two is really, unlike my comparison of, say, Jackson to McClellan, where they're polar opposites, here there's so many similarities, at least in the effect of the death. You had, you know, they became the symbolism of their death, I guess, was similar. Their funerals were the funerals that all these hundreds of thousands of young men would never have. When they returned home symbolically by train, it was the journey home that the young men would never have. There was all of this. I mean, it was kind of, they were the vessels into which the pent-up heartache, as I write in the book, of the nation could be poured. And Drew Gilpin Faust called Lincoln's, what happened after Lincoln's death, the national funeral. And the national funeral was exactly what it was for the Confederacy. Mm-hmm. And before I stop here, I'll say just one more thing. When the trains were going home, you had of course Lincoln going to New York, you had Jackson going to Lynchburg. The scale was vastly different. But when Lincoln died, generally the South still hated him. They thought they would have had a better deal with him than who came after him, but they hated him. In Jackson, curiously, there were many outpourings of admiration and genuine mourning in the North, even among abolitionists. A lot of people in the North thought he was fighting in the wrong cause, but thought he was a Christian gentleman and a brilliant warrior, and in some cases, they were kind of proud to claim him. And somebody once said to have fought against him was just after having fought under him. Mm-hmm.
Now, another tool that you use to bring Stonewall Jackson to life is identifying historical tipping points. The Battle of Winchester is the tipping point for the birth of the myth and legend of Stonewall Jackson. The Battle of Second Manassas is almost the tipping point for de facto Confederate independence. Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation is the tipping point for the Union's finally becoming impassioned about winning the war. And finally, Jackson's death as the tipping point for the South's decline towards certain defeat. So is that the historian's job, to identify the precise moment or event when momentum shifts and the tide turns?
Yes, and it is something that I find missing in a lot of history, that sense of just stepping back a little bit and saying that here is what this means. Here is what Second Manassas meant. Here is what... for example, when I was talking about the Romney campaign, which is it's this winter campaign, it's not a success. And Jackson ends up resigning. It's messy. He's meddled with by Richmond and so what I but with Romney, to me, I think it's my job to point out, which I do in the book. I say, yeah, but if you're paying close attention, this was an example. This was an exercise of a new style of command that nobody had ever seen before. Men were going to be made to march that way. They were going to be made to die. They were going to follow the leader, and they were going to do what he said, and they were going to take risks. And all these things, it was a completely new concept in command at that point. That it wasn't what people thought this was about. Mm-hmm. Soldiers freezing to death in the 18-degree weather with 30-mile-an-hour winds. And if you go to something like, and of course, this is obvious, all historians have pointed this out, but you know, the Battle of Antietam, which Jackson fought in, was in a larger historical sense about giving Lincoln the ability to issue the Emancipation Proclamation. So yeah, I think those meaningful moments, the Battle of Winchester is what put him on the map. By 14 months into the war, we had already had the Battle of Winchester by that point. Jackson was being compared to Napoleon. Jackson was the most famous military man in the Western world. This was the Valley Campaign. And so I say, it's my job to point out and say, hey, Winchester changed everything. Suddenly, you have this man who is who embodies the hope for the beleaguered South.
Yeah, as I read all that, and just as the Union soldiers feared the sound of the rebel yell after Winchester, they feared the sound of the name Stonewall Jackson.
They do.
Because of...
There's some great moments, too, where you can see that what's at play is not anything real, but it's the idea of Jackson. You can see it at Hooker in the first day of Chancellorsville, where he suddenly finds out that it's Jackson and not these other two generals in the field against him. It affects your decision-making. Suddenly, they were thinking, no, I'm going to change my tactics, which, in fact, changed the battle. The best example of this that I can think of is there's a moment after Harper's Ferry where Jackson swallows an entire Union Army whole in Harper's Ferry, and there's a moment where there's this big Union Army coming through this ridge toward Harper's Ferry. And between them and the garrison in Harper's Ferry, they vastly outnumber Jackson. They outgun him, they outnumber him, they out everything Jackson. And there's a moment when here come the Union troops through the pass on to what should have been certain victory. And suddenly they hear all these, the rebel yell, people giving the rebel yell, the rebels are going crazy. The Union guys say, what are you guys celebrating for? And they said, well, the sound of gunfire just stopped from Harper's Ferry. That means that Jackson has taken Harper's Ferry. And at this point, it was entirely the idea of Jackson, this mysterious, remote, sort of magical force that had just eaten another Union Army whole. And the Union general stops. Just stops. And McClellan can't make a move. And that's the end of it. There was a bunch of that, and I think that when you are in war, I think in general, when your opponent is known, one of the reasons that Lee did what or could do what he did early on against the Union forces is because it was a reverse effect. He knew who McClellan was.
Mm-hmm. Now, in an interview in last Sunday's Dallas Morning News, you were asked if there were any lessons from the life of Stonewall Jackson that we can apply today. And your answer, surprisingly to me at least, was, I can't make any direct contacts with 2014, though you went on to explain why Jackson still lives on today. But aren't there lessons to be learned on how to be a great leader in 2014 that can be learned and better understood by knowing how Stonewall Jackson went about taking care of his business, his leadership business during mm-hmm. the Civil War?
You know, there are. I didn't take the question that they asked me that way. I thought they were trying to link it to current events.
Oh, okay.
And I can't link it to Afghanistan, although many people, we've had discussions about the Comanches in Afghanistan. But no, I think, yes, absolutely. I tell people some great lessons. One, arrest all your generals. Two, don't care a whit for what you do to your men. Punish them, make them march in snow and hurt them. Never tell any of your staff anything about what you're doing, even in the middle of battle. Okay, this is all true. I'm not making this up. Jackson had a very eccentric style. But as I was saying earlier, the things that you would, you know, could trot out at a management seminar in 2014 are this... remarkable decisiveness, remarkable ability to use command, ability to use his authority and his command. I would say aggressiveness, speed, all the things that, you know, Patton studied him closely, the Germans studied him closely and acted accordingly. Deception. Again, this is when you're looking at, if you're looking at, like, say, the corporate world, these things would be very helpful to you. Mm-hmm. You know, decide what you do. Stick by your gun. Stick to what you're doing. He was in some ways a leader, a great leader in spite of himself. He wasn't perfect. He was flawed, and yet, you know, there were questions when Jackson's brother-in-law D.H. Hill, who was a Confederate general, was asked why the men follow Jackson so blindly, and he said, well, because he wins. And Hill was a cynical guy, and that was a cynical sort of answer. And I think that you could maybe make the same statement about Nick Saban. What, you want to play for Nick Saban? Well, why do you want to play for Nick Saban? Well, he wins. He may not. He didn't have to be Mother Teresa. He doesn't have to be anything else. He has to win. So that was part of it. But he also, but Jackson was, I compare him in the book to Longstreet. So Lee's two main lieutenants in the early war were Jackson and James Longstreet. Now, Longstreet was the plotter. I mean, he was a good fighter, and he was brave, but he was a color, not a very colorful personality, and he was just Longstreet. Jackson, on the other hand, was, I mean, he was remote, generally speaking, from his men. He was, again, prayed in battle, prayed in the middle of battle. Jackson was about, as I was saying, sort of magic and mystery and other things. And you know, Longstreet inspired respect among the Union troops. Jackson, it was fear and awe. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure how good a management that lesson that is.
Well, you know, he wasn't into pomp and circumstances.
No.
He was humble. I mean, you know, you read Good to Great.
Right.
These are the traits, but...
That is true. That's a good point. But the humility, the willing to give credit to others, all of that was, I think, a significant part of who he was.
I'm glad you brought up the Nick Saban, because another way to look at Jackson's relevance as a role model for leadership in 2014, as I read it, was to compare him to UT's head football coach, Charlie Strong, who you profiled in Texas Monthly a year ago, because let me rattle off some of these things. I thought, my gosh. He cared little about the opinions of others, paren alums. He firmly stripped the companies of their independence and hammered them together into regiments, a team effort. He imposed an unforgiving program of drill and instruction and got rid of the whiskey. He required officers to remain habitually with their commands, like the coaches sleeping in the dorms. His penalties were prompt and inexorable, such that rules were rules, violations were violations, and consequences must follow. He was all about scrupulous honesty, meticulous accountability, cool professionalism, and his obsession with detail was seen as proof of an iron will. These are all about Stonewall Jackson, but that's what we've been reading in the sports pages about Charlie Strong.
That's brilliant. Okay, that's flat brilliant. Okay, I could never have made that connection. You just made it, and you're exactly right. Everything that he said was my description of Jackson, but it applies exactly. Yeah. So you're exactly right. All right. But that was it's hard for me sometimes to sort of get a handle on, because there's so much to Jackson. But you put your finger on it there. It's all those things that you said. And there's a complete and utter consistency all the time of it. There is never, it's sort of like, you know, Michael Corleone or, you know, The Godfather. It's not, you know, it's not personal, it's business. And it wasn't, if Jackson was going to take you out and shoot you and your guys for having come to him and said, look, the draft is up, we're out of here, that was not personal with him. That was, and you knew it, and you knew you would be shot. And he was very even-handed when he had his first command in Harper's Ferry. He had to break the militias, because the war started out where everybody thought this is going to be a hoot, and they were all these old militias, and the militias all had generals, and the generals had plumes in their hats and sabers and entourages, and they would pass out whiskey and cigars, and they believed they were going to retain their authority. And Jackson just absolutely broke them on the wheel, but he did it fairly, and he did it consistently. And they all went to Richmond to complain and get rid of him, and it didn't work, and he came back. But he was a terrifically even-handed administrator, and it was all, and so much of the war, of the, when you see the dramatics of the early war, are generals with big egos, mm-hmm, doing things they shouldn't be doing. Mm-hmm.
And another 2014 relevant lesson that to me was triggered by Jackson's life story is the importance of choosing a career path that allows a person to fully use his strengths, fulfill his destiny, do what he was born to do, and get into a mode of what contemporary psychologists call flow. And your book makes clear that during wartime, Stonewall Jackson was absolutely in a perfect state of flow whenever he led his troops into battle. So you use the word redemption, the violence, passion, and redemption of Stonewall Jackson. Redemption has many different definitions, and so I looked it up. And were you defining redemption as Jackson's ultimate fulfillment of his human potential? Or if that's not it, tell me what the redemption's about.
No, that's one meaning of it, but I would start that with, I mean, I use the word very deliberately, and the first the first sense of it would be purely religious. Jackson was a devout Christian, therefore he saw himself as a sinner, and therefore a sinner to be redeemed by the grace of God. And he believed that he would be redeemed by the grace of God after when he died. And he actually looked forward to that as a devout Christian. He looked forward to that moment. So redeemed in that very specific sense, that he would be and he believed he would be. Well, then there's the other side, which you hinted at, the more secular side of the word redeemed, which might be redeemed from his own failures, redeemed from his own ordinariness, fulfilling things that he should have done or wanted to do.
If the Civil War hadn't come along, he would have been a forgotten VMI professor that no one would ever even thought about.
Yeah, a nice little guy with a little job and just the odd major he would have been. And there's a moment. It's longer than a moment, but in the winter of 1862, 1863, Jackson was, the Battle of Fredericksburg had just been fought, resounding Confederate victory, and the Confederate Army was camped up on the hills near the Rappahannock, near Fredericksburg, and Jackson at that point was, they just had this string of great victories, and even the loss, Antietam, was a drawn battle against twice their size. He and Lee had done absolutely extraordinary things, and he had fulfilled everything that you could have imagined that a military man could have wanted. He was famous. He was a rock star. He was swarmed in public. Women would literally throw themselves on him to get buttons on his coat and locks of his hair. Men were stealing hairs from his horse's tail. I have a description in my book by Jeb Seward's chief of staff, who's mistaken for him. He describes it as like fleeing through this town with this mob in pursuit, and he gets in a hotel and he's got to barricade himself into the hotel. That's how famous Jackson was. Well, Jackson didn't like that, but it was a fulfillment of sorts. The other fulfillment, this is much more interesting to me, was that he, in the winter of 1862, 1863, Jackson almost single-handedly, I don't want to say that's too extreme, Jackson was the principal driving force behind the unbelievable wave of Christian revivals that swept through the Confederate Army that winter. There were going to be more to come in the war, but this is Jackson's last winter on earth. He refused to be the front man. He refused to preach. He refused to require any of his men to go to church services. He didn't do any of that. But he actively recruited and financed the regimental chaplains, which is really the way he pushed it into the army. He was very aggressive with this. He used his own money to finance literature and everything. Again, he was behind the scenes. He would go to the services, but in that winter, you suddenly saw chapels being built everywhere, and generals like Lee and Jackson at all these services and these great revivals. And even though he couldn't have been that Presbyterian minister that he should have been and wanted to be, in fact, he had more of an effect on people than many of the, you know, this was the era, of course, of the great revivals and great preachers in the revivals. In some ways, he had more of an effect than mm-hmm. they did. So we can talk about this, I think, all under the general banner of redemption.
Yeah. Now, a huge part of Stonewall Jackson's story was his historic partnership with Robert E. Lee. Lee being the tactician, Jackson being, quote, the iron fist and righteous tool of destruction. And on page 560, you say that after Jackson's death, Robert E. Lee would never again be so brilliant. Is it accurate to say that Lee's high historical legacy came about in large part because he had Stonewall Jackson's and his heroics in his toolkit?
It depends on what you look at. In the larger sense, yes. I mean, Lee had what he said was the greatest executive officer the sun ever shone. And I mean, it was true. And the Lee-Jackson partnership was made in heaven. I mean, you could make a buddy movie out of it. They were opposite personalities, but they were extraordinarily effective in battle. And it was, in fact, a form of high command teamwork, absolutely unseen in the war to that point. Now, in individual battles, the first campaign that the two fought together was the 7 days, which was just an absolute miserable, sloppy piece of work from everybody's point of view. Lee didn't know how to move armies yet. Jackson performed badly a couple of times. But the effect of 7 days, of course, was that Lee became hugely famous by driving George McClellan and his entire 120,000-man army into the James River, where they cowered behind the behind their gunboats. But once the team starts going, which you see at Second Manassas, it's really just absolutely extraordinary. What they're able to do together, they think alike. And one of the things I say in my book is that when Jackson first started operating the Shenandoah Valley, the place where his Valley campaign would be, where he first became so famous, what happened was he was nominally reporting to a general named Joseph Johnston, but in fact Johnston was way preoccupied with the defense of Richmond, as increasingly Jefferson Davis was. And so Davis basically said to his military sidekick at that point, Robert E. Lee, he said, hey, look, we're too busy with the defense of Richmond. Why don't you look after the Valley? And it started this extraordinary correspondence between the two men. At that point, Lee was seen as not necessarily who you wanted in field command. Mm-hmm. He hadn't performed that well in the war. Mm-hmm. He was thought to be a little fussy. He wasn't what anybody later found out that he was. But in his correspondence with Jackson, Jackson is really the first one to see this profoundly aggressive riverboat gambler, risk-taking guy. And one of the reasons Jackson was able to do the Valley is he had this little voice, this little man standing on his shoulder, Robert E. Lee, saying, you know, using terms like, if you can drive the enemy, move the enemy. And so in purely military terms, the two of them discovered each other, these very aggressive guys. In early in the war, where aggressiveness wasn't yet perceived as a value everybody wanted, and in fact, people thought Jackson was a bit of an attack dog who mm-hmm. should be reined in.
Now, last question. Although in 2014 we're in the midst of the Civil War's sesquicentennial, today we're living in a strange, politically correct world, such that as we speak, there are actually political activists in places like Charlottesville, Virginia, who are trying to have removed from public places all statues and monuments related to the Confederacy. So as your book vividly depicts the amazing wartime accomplishments of Stonewall Jackson and his dauntless courage and his consummate generalship demonstrated by his string of military successes from 1861 until his death in 1863, I wonder what coverage of his life, if any, is being taught to America's school children these days?
I don't know, not very much. It's interesting, there's a Stonewall Jackson Elementary School in Dallas that I think is in play too. It's the Civil War. One of the things that you learn as a Yankee, I'm as Connecticut Yankee as you get. We were just brought up to, the Civil War was really simple if you grew up in Connecticut, trust me. It wasn't hard to figure out why it was being fought and who won, and we didn't pay much attention to it, frankly. And we being, you know, Yankees, Connecticut Yankees. But the Civil War is it's an extremely sort of complicated thing. And to slavery was the larger reason why it was fought. And in fact, it was America's inability to know what to do with its new territories, this gigantic amount of new territories that dwarfed the original colonies that it had acquired since the Louisiana Purchase. And it was, what are we going to do with it? That's what the Civil War was really about. So it was about what will the nation in the future be about slavery, not about slavery. But when you come to, in my book, I talk a lot about slavery and Jackson's relationship to it. And one of the things you learn is that it's never as simple as you thought it was going to be. Jackson came from the western part of Virginia, which was where his uncle Cummins had 12 slaves, but slaves were uncommon there. Not only that, but western Virginia de-seceded from the Confederacy as soon as Virginia seceded. And so he was from a part of the country that actually went for the North. He himself had 6 slaves, 3 of which were reclamation projects. People had asked him to, one of them wanted his freedom, another, 3 of them came through his wife. He was, as far as we know, a benevolent owner, although he did not have any views that said that slaves were not property. He and his wife believed that they were. On the other hand, he started and ran a very successful Sunday school for slaves in Lexington that had 100 students at one point. He did this in violation of Virginia law. The Virginia law, which was based on the Nat Turner Rebellion of the 1830s, said that, you know, if you taught slaves to read, in this case the Bible, or taught them to be literate, they would rise up and kill you. And so Jackson did this in contravention of Virginia law, and he was, in fact, accosted in the street a number of occasions that I describe in the book by people who said, you can't do this. Jackson's interest was saving souls, but he ran a good school. People liked it, and to this day, there's a, this is part of the complexity of the South, there is a stained glass window in a black church in Virginia put there by one of Jackson's old students. Anyway, then we get into the war itself, slavery, when Jackson's, in his Valley campaign, was the first time that slaves crossed lines in large numbers. I think it was one of the first times, anyway, crossing to Nathaniel Banks' army and the Union army, but believed that Jackson would kill them, and there was many different levels of this, I guess, and that while, I mean, you know, obviously one condemns slavery, but the Confederacy was a large, and the South as a whole was a very large and complex entity, and that you can't just rule it off with, rule it out or dismiss it, if you will, as a single issue cause.
Well, I think all of us are tremendously indebted to you for bringing Stonewall Jackson alive at a time when we're living in this very unusual world with this attitude toward the South and the Confederacy and trying to demonize so much of it. So thank you for this wonderful book. Let's show our appreciation to S.C. Gwynne.
Thank you.